era of additive manufacturing, I believe that few of you are already know the Capital Goods Skill Council activities and what exactly Capital Goods Skill Council is all about. But still, for the new people, I just wanted to introduce the Capital Goods Skill Council. Just give me 1 minute. In the meantime, may I request all the participants to kindly keep your mic and camera in switch off mode. I hope my screen is visible. Mohit, are you there? Can you see it?
Yes, I can see your screen. I can see the screen.
So Capital Goods Skill Council is basically formed under the aegis of Skill India, an initiative which was started in 2013-14, in fact, by our Honorable Prime Minister, Shri Narendra Modi ji. Why exactly we people came into existence? Because we understood that there are certain requirements of the industry as far as workforce is concerned. So by the help of industry, we have designed national occupational standards, which are right now on which we people are imparting the training through our more than 800 training centers across India. We work on quality assurance parameters when we are talking about the assessment and certifications. We are also into training of trainers and also the assessors. We promote academics of excellence for the sectors. Right now, we are also working on a very on a labor market information system also, just to provide or get an insight that what type of workforce is going to be there for in next 5 years. Apart from that, we are also promoting apprenticeship and recognition of prior learning in various sectors, but in manufacturing sector only. So the 10 subsectors on which we people are right now working are machine tools, metal forming, foundry, forging, textile, plastic machineries, process equipment, construction, electrical, material, and automation. Need not to mention that we people are promoted by National Skill Development Corporations, DHI, and FICCI. It gives me an immense pleasure to tell you that right now Strategic Sector Skill Council is also merged with the Capital Goods Skill Council. So we have extended our horizons into subsectors like defense, shipping, homeland security, and fire and safety equipment. As far as Capital Goods Skill Council is working is concerned, we are having a governing council who look after all the activities which we are undertaking right now. So as I already mentioned beforehand, we are promoted by DHI, FICCI, and NSDC. A few very good associations who are part of our governing council are Indian Machine Tools Manufacturers Association, Plastic Machine Manufacturers Association of India, Process Plant Manufacturers Association of India, Tools and Gauge Manufacturers Association, Textile Machine Manufacturers Association, Indian Textile and Machine Manufacturers Association. Then we are also got accepted with Engineering Export Promotion Council. Some PSUs who are already working with us are HMT, HEC, BHEL, BEL, OFP, BEM. Then we are also having the private sectors who are part of our governing council. L&T, Gainwell, Bharat Forge, Gusti are a few of the names. Then Siemens, Festo, Panuk and Stag is also there. As I already mentioned that we are having affiliated training centers across India. So this is the pie diagram, which actually shows that where exactly the people are presented across India. But all activities and achievements we have taken so far, as I mentioned that we are already having 55 qualification packs with over 96 unique national occupational standards. We are promoting skilling specifically in manufacturing sector based on these 55 qualification packs. Right now, we are also in the process of coming up with Industry 4.0 qualification packs. So far, we have trained more than 100,000 trainees and 893 trainers and 463 assessors centers are already there with us. Time to time, just to promote the new things, which new technologies basically, we are doing many workshops and seminars. For example, like today only we are talking about additive manufacturing. Recently, in past 6 months, we have done approximately 6 or 7 seminars on different technology parameters on Industry 4.0 only. As far as the partnerships are concerned, we got 896 affiliated training centers. There are 15 designated TOT centers with us. We are also having 10 designated center of excellence. We are having a partnership with each and every state skill mission. Then we are also having a partnership with Skill Universities Academy. And to name few, the Chitkara is one, C.V. Raman Institute University is there, VSDU is there. The CGSE job roles, as I mentioned that we are having 55 qualification packs. So all these 55 qualification packs are basically divided into 12 occupationals. The machining is one which covers all the CNC related activities, cutting, building, fitting. For the details, I request you all to kindly visit the CGSE's qualification packs, because to name each and every qualification pack here is not a good idea. As I mentioned that Strategic Manufacturing Sector Skill Council is going to be part of Capital Goods Skill Council. On the job roles which are actually working right now under Strategic Manufacturing is shipping, technicians, ship scrappers, design engineers, marine fitter and riggers, larger insulators, design engineers, pipe fitters, and technician installations. These are few of the job roles on which we are going to start our working very soon. We are one of the premier partners for India Skills and World Skills Competition. Last year, one of our trainee has also got bronze medal in welding competition held at Kazan. The name of the guy is Kolyapeshri Reddy. These are those job roles on which we people are doing the competitions. As I mentioned earlier that right now we have started working on Industry 4.0 job roles in Capital Goods Skill Council. So these are few of those job roles on which we are very soon coming up with our qualification packs. In fact, we are also looking forward to have an interaction with the industry people to understand that what exactly Industry 4.0 job roles they are looking forward to, so that we can also start working on the same. As far as CGSE is concerned, we are also promoting interaction with industries, where exactly we are assisting the industries, getting the workforce to the industry. This is, we people are not charging anything for that. We are also into upskilling and reskilling of existing employees. This is also one of the government initiative which has recently launched under Skill India initiative. Apart from that, we are also providing an opportunity to explore industry-owned training centers and adopt existing centers under CSR initiatives. Recently, we have also taken, we are also working on one of the CSR initiative with one of the PSUs, specifically in Karnataka. We help industry in apprenticeship and national apprenticeship promotion scheme. We also look forward to have an interaction with the industry participation in World Skills Competition. I just mentioned that last to last year, one of our trainee has won bronze medal in World Skills. So that is because of the industry's participation. Last but not least, recently we have launched our own placement portal for our member companies. We are giving them the access to have to access the good quality workforce for them, which is going to be recently we have interacted with many of the industries, and unfortunately we came to know about this thing that after the COVID situation, many of the industries are actually not getting the right workforce to work from them. So after having an understanding from the industry people, we have got this own placement portal for the manufacturing companies only. And we request you to kindly ask your HR people to register on this particular portal. Right now, the registrations are free of cost. They can go ahead, they can post their jobs, and then they can, the certified candidates of CGSE, they can approach them directly for the jobs postings by them. These are the credentials of Capital Good Skill Council. Now I invite Mohit. Now I invite Mr. Mohit Sakpara from Inventive 3D to be part of this webinar. And Mohit, over to you, please.
Hello. Good morning to everyone. It is a very big opportunity to be able to deliver this content on the platform of CGSE. Harsh, am I clear? Can you hear me?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. So this gives me an immense pleasure being on this platform. And today, let's look forward and learn more parameters and some insights on additive manufacturing. So basically, additive manufacturing is a part of Industry 4.0, as Harsh just mentioned, that they are working in the field of concepts which are very, very much suitable and for Industry 4.0. So additive manufacturing is very much part of it. So let me just start with my presentation. Is the presentation visible?
Yes, Mohit, it is visible.
Okay. So let us start with what actually additive
manufacturing. Your voice is not audible.
Mohit, your voice is breaking.
Is it more audible now?
It is audible, but there are some distortion is there.
Okay. I think it will be better now.
Yes, it is better now.
Yeah. So 3D printing is basically a concept. It is a host of processes combined together. I mean, like when you talk about a host of processes, there are different manufacturing processes like drilling, milling, cutting. Combine all those processes together, and that is what 3D printing is like. It gives you the entire object at a time.
Your voice is not audible, sir.
Give me a second. Let me fix this.
But basically, your voice is audible, but unfortunately, some distortion is there.
Okay. Just give me a second. Let me fix it. I think this will be... am I clear now, Harsh?
Yes, now it is clear.
Okay. So as I was talking, it is a host of processes combined together, and it gives you, you know, an entire object manufactured out of a machine. So you don't need to go to different set of machines. You don't need a drill machine for a hole. You don't need a turning machine for your, you know, setting up your diameters and taking your machining phases. So this is what 3D printing basically is. It is also called as layer printing. As we all know what layer printing basically is, it prints layer upon layer. It grows the object from bottom to top. That is what additive manufacturing is all about. So let me be clear. There are various and different kinds of additive manufacturing processes, which we'll take a look at it in the presentation ahead. So this, there are different kinds of processes like FDM, there are DMLS. So you need to select the raw material and the equipment according to your needs. So this is what additive manufacturing overall is. So let me tell you what the process looks like. Am I audible? Hello?
Yes, Mohit, you are audible.
Harsh?
Mohit, you are audible. We can see your screen also.
Okay. So this is how it works. You need to have a design. That is a CAD model initially. You need a CAD model. It can be designed in any of the CAD softwares like SolidWorks, NX, CATIA, PROE. So you have to have a design of your component which you need to 3D print, or which is, you know, this is the raw material for 3D printing. Design is a basic and a must. Then you have to upload it to the software which is connected with your 3D printer. It is also called as a printware. It acts as an interface between your design and the machine. According to your requirement and according to the product that you want to print, you have to select the raw material for it and a suitable technology to print that material. After that, it starts, the machine starts, and you get your output. So basically, before your printing, you need to have your design and you have to select the machine and the material according to it. So this is overall how the process of additive manufacturing works. Here is a small video, a time lapse of how a FDM 3D printer works. And here you can see it, once I play the video, you'll be able to see how an object grows from bottom to top. So this is how the object grew from bottom to top. What it does is it keeps on
Mohit, your voice is not audible. You are on mute. Mohit, your voice is not audible. Yes, now it is audible.
Yeah. Sorry, I have some connection issues, I guess. I think with the bandwidth. So let us have a look at some of the 3D printing materials that are available. The most commonly available material is PLA. It is a kind of plastic. And then there are other kinds of plastics like PLA, ABS, nylon, carbon fiber, PETG, PP, PC, POM. All such different kinds of plastics are available for 3D printing in FDM technology. Then we have certain resins that come in form of raw material. There are certain metals that you can 3D print. You can 3D print using paper, fabric, concrete, and also certain biomedical materials. So these are, this is an overview of kinds of materials that can be used for additive manufacturing. Let's move on to the next slide. So these are different and various kinds of 3D printers, how they look like. These are certain machines which are available in the market. You can see it from different brands and different sizes. Machines start from a desktop model and it goes up to industrial range of machine. Here you can see industrial grade of 3D printer. This is from one of the companies called 3D Systems. This is used for when you have small batch production and when you want a few quantity of components that you need to make using additive manufacturing technology. So this is an industrial grade 3D printer. It is kind of a size of a big room, you can say a conference room basically. Let us also talk on some of the possibilities and areas where 3D printing is very much impactful. Using additive manufacturing technology, you can basically do a lot of customization work in various fields like medical devices, prosthetics. You know, the main advantage of additive manufacturing is 100% customization. So you can manufacture a product and which is 100% customized according to your requirements and your necessity. Also goes with dental implants, hearing aids, sunglasses, phone covers. You know, wherever you can customize, you can use additive manufacturing. And the main strength of additive manufacturing has always been customization of products. And then the other possibility and the area where additive manufacturing makes a big impact is complex manufacturing. Like when you have components which are dimensionally very important, whose looks are not important, but the dimensions are very much important, and you need precision in those components, you can use additive manufacturing for such components. You can achieve this complex intricacy of geometry, and you can manufacture goods which are very much complex to manufacture using traditional methods of manufacturing. And then are also other applications of additive manufacturing in this area. Like for an example, space applications. Like they have a 3D printer, a FDM 3D printer installed in the International Space Station in 2002. And now they are planning to install a metal 3D printer by the end of this year. They might have a metal 3D printer on board International Space Station. So you can go and print your objects at the site itself where it is needed. And or you just need to have a design inventory and you can manufacture any component. It can also be thought in another way, like when there is a ship and it goes to sail for around 3 months, 4 months, and there is a requirement of certain components. You can have a design library on board and you can manufacture a component on board itself using additive manufacturing technology. So these are certain possibilities wherein additive manufacturing plays a big role. There are, when we see in the recent times in the situation of COVID, there was always a big problem in the supply chain. I think some industry is still facing this problem. One of the ways where additive manufacturing can come in hand in the field of supply chain is like, divide the component. Like if you have a assembly of 15 components, you design it in such a way that you reduce the assembly to around 10 components, 5 components, and it will make easy for manufacturing and the supply chain. The other thing is like, if you have a machine here and your designer is somewhere else, or I just need to send you a few samples overseas, what I can do is I can just share you the design. You can prototype it using additive manufacturing on site. So it will save a lot of time and a few components and the raw material also. So this is one of the possibilities. And as we know, Industry 4.0 is the next revolution in the field of additive manufacturing. The very basic, additive manufacturing and Industry 4.0 can be connected in a few of these subtopics. It is a method of digital manufacturing. Industry 4.0 is a data-driven industry where everything works on data and data utilization. The same thing here works with additive manufacturing. It is also a kind of digital manufacturing, you can say. Additive manufacturing is also a digital method of manufacturing. You can do mass customization, control the quality. Your prototyping can be made faster and sooner. When you have low volume for production, you can go ahead with additive manufacturing, and soon for also high volume products. You can have a virtual inventory of all your components at a time, at a place. You know, additive manufacturing also gives you an option when you want to innovate. Like when you are innovating a product or you are designing a concept, you need to make some iterations. Additive manufacturing lets you make those iterations very easily and cost effective at the same time. So this is more of additive manufacturing and how it can be combined. But on my stand on additive manufacturing will always be more on integrating the existing manufacturing method with the industry 4.0. So additive manufacturing cannot entirely replace traditional method of manufacturing.
Mohit, are you there? I extend my apologies. I believe that due to some internet connectivity, we have got lost touch with Mohit, and I believe that he will be back soon. I request you all to kindly bear with us.
Hello. Am I audible? Hello.
Yes. Nice to see you back.
Oh, sorry for the inconvenience. This doesn't usually happen, but I don't know. I'm facing some problem with the internet today. So can you see my screen?
Yes, we can see your screen. I request you to kindly switch off your camera so that we can use the bandwidth properly.
Can you see my screen? Hello?
Yes, it is visible. Go ahead.
Yes, I did that. Okay. So as we were talking about additive manufacturing and connecting it with industry 4.0, so these are a few parameters wherein industry 4.0 is connected with additive manufacturing. So this is what a traditional manufacturing industry looks like most probably. And these are today's scenario in the industry where we think that these things need to be upgraded, and what Industry 4.0 will make it look like will be something like this. So we call it the factories of tomorrow, and the factories of tomorrow will have 3D printers, a farms of So this will how it look like, you know, the factories of tomorrow would look like. And sorry, I think I faced the problem again. Let me show you a video of how additive manufacturing works with metals. So it is called as DMLS. It is also called as digital metal laser sintering. Or you can also commonly talk as metal 3D printing. So this is how it looks like, and here is a small video. So this is how metal 3D printing looks like, and as we all saw, it uses raw material as powder, metal powder as raw material, and it uses laser to sinter the raw material. It adds, it sinters layer upon layer of metal and gives you an object in metal 3D printing. So this is a area where, you know, there is vast scope in the industry where industry can utilize additive manufacturing and can have metal prototypes as well as functioning and working prototype, where you can actually directly take the component out of a metal printer and you can check the functionality and the working of the component. So this is how it works. There is another technology where, you know, everyone might have always think about which are the materials that can be used for 3D printing. So FRP and composites are also one of the materials that you can always utilize when you have lightweight applications and you also need strength at the same time. So there are, you know, different kinds of composite materials which additive manufacturing uses. This is a small video showing how FRPs can be used. this is how precise you can print using using composite materials, and you can also integrate certain filaments and certain composite materials with the existing other materials like plastics and metals and all using this technology of additive manufacturing. There is one other field which is in the field of construction. You can use additive manufacturing in the field of construction. You can actually use concrete as a raw material and you can print a house out of it. Recently, L&T and L&T did this additive manufacturing for construction in Chennai. And there are also other companies coming up who want to get into the field of construction using additive manufacturing. So now, as I discussed other materials, this is a special technology of additive manufacturing wherein you use liquids as raw materials, which we call as resin. The raw material is in the form of liquid and the object grows it grows from bottom to top, but in the inverse way, for which we have a small video to let you know how it works. So this is how you can use resin as a raw material. Basically, resin is a photosensitive liquid. Once light falls on this material, it gets cured. It gets kind of sintered or cured, you can say. And from liquid to it turns into a solid, and the layer adds upon the other layer, and you can have an entire object. These are photosensitive materials. By photosensitive materials, they are very sensitive to UV light or maybe even natural light. So there are different kinds of resin whose sensitivity depends on what kind of application you need, and you can set all those parameters and get a object. Most of the time, this technology is used to print objects from the field of jewelry and defense components, certain satellite components which are very delicate and which needs very much precision, where there are complexities and small parameters involved. So these are the industries that use 3D printing, which can use 3D printing. When we see the
Mohit, I'm so sorry, but your voice is breaking again.
The major industry that uses additive manufacturing is the automotive. Am I audible now?
No, it is better.
Harsh, can you hear me?
No, it is better, Mohit.
Hello.
Mohit, now it is better.
Yeah, it is better, right? Sorry for the inconvenience again. I don't know why I am facing this problem today. So these are certain areas where, you know, you can use additive manufacturing. These are certain industries. And here is a small table wherein different sectors of industries are already using additive manufacturing. Aerospace, healthcare, forging industry, jewelry industry. You can also use this, you know, where you have certain entertainment or hobby or creative ideas. You can use this technology and bring to life your favorite characters and design. Also, you know, there is a big area of in the field of education. Basically, our field, additive manufacturing, needs a lot of manpower, skilled manpower, who can do various, you know, upgradations in the existing methods of manufacturing. And wherein, you know, big industries like casting, forging, and modeling industries can come up, start utilizing this new method of manufacturing. So this is one area wherein an electric bike was entirely 3D printed, assembled, and this is just a functional prototype right now. And here is a small video of it. So this is just one of the examples wherein automotive industry has used additive manufacturing for making actual and working functional prototypes. So this is one of the areas. The second is aerospace, wherein aerospace industry can use this technology for making, you know, components which are very much critical to the industry. Here is a small video onto which how aerospace is using this. So all these components are components of an engine, a jet propulsion engine, and they are using this technology and this method of metal manufacturing for their very much precise and critical components, wherein, you know, they just design the component using a CAD software and then metal print it, assemble, and then test it. So there is a recent startup, aerospace startup called Agnikul. They entirely 3D printed their jet engine and they also test fire it. So now India has also started adopting and utilizing the method of additive manufacturing in the field of aerospace. As we earlier discussed, the application of additive manufacturing in the area of construction. So this is a small video of it. So this is where the construction industry is using concrete as a raw material for additive manufacturing, and this house was entirely made using additive manufacturing technology just in one day. It is very much cost effective, time saving. You can connect this idea with when it comes to India, you can think about, you know, slum redevelopment and all using the method of additive manufacturing, so that you know, it makes slum redevelopment a faster process and easy and a more cost effective process. So these are certain advantages of 3D printing. As we discussed earlier, you know, fast manufacturing, accurate products, improved research and development. It will also save a lot of time. You can save a lot of time in your research when you you know, it gives you a flexibility to have a factory on your desktop. You can actually design a component, you can take it out of a 3D printer, take the functionality and the other parameters. If there are certain problems, go back to the design and do the process again. So this will also save a lot of time. You don't need to manufacture dies and molds and patterns for every component that you want to manufacture. You can have a prototype before going for production. So what I can say here, additive manufacturing not only gives you an option for final and final components for utilization and functionality, but it also gives you an option to pre-plan your production and your production process, and also gives you an option to check the functionality and the durability of the component. So these are certain advantages of 3D printing, you can say, or you can say it as an additive manufacturing. So this is, sorry for the inconvenience, and this is an overview of what additive manufacturing is all about. No, I would be glad to answer your doubts and questions if you have.
Thank you very much, Mohit. And there are certain questions which has been asked by the participants, and I'm just putting every question one by one with you.
Yes, please. Yes.
So the very first question which I have received, it says that when you 3D print for steel, can we achieve density of 7.85 grams per cubic centimeter, which is actually an equivalent weight of steel, wrought steel?
Okay. To answer this, yes, you can achieve this density, but you need to have a very precise metal printer. And you can also use a different kind of metal printing, wherein after your component is printed, the raw material, the metal comes in the form of a clay metal, and then you need to sinter it and cure it so that you can achieve this same density.
The second question which I have received is that what will be the typical cost of raw material for 3D printing? For example, if it is going to be steel, plastic, resin.
Okay. Let me give you a rough idea. The plastics that we are talking of, which are used in FDM, the cost of raw material starts from around 1,000 rupees a kg, the plastic. So that is 1 kg for 1,000 rupees. And metals, they are expensive, and resins are expensive. Resin comes around 7,000 to 8,000 rupees per liter. And the metals, they also come in the range of 7,000 to 8,000 per kg, because it comes in the form of powder.
One more question which I have received is that can we also make PET bottles by using the ISBM processes?
You can make PET bottles, but I think only for prototyping purposes, not for mass production, because blow molding is a very fast process for making PET bottles. And that is the most suitable. But what you can do is you can integrate. You can manufacture the mold for PET bottles out of a metal 3D printer. You can integrate it that way.
One very interesting question which I have received from the manufacturers is that they manufacture punches and dies by using the HCHCRD2 grade raw material for their press tools. So they were asking that what type of raw material they can use so that the cost wise it is very competitive.
If they want to actually use the die for manufacturing process, they need metals. So currently there are 8 kinds of alloys which are available for metal printing. One of which they can use is OHNS, oil hardened nickel steel. So that is available for metal 3D printing. Metal 3D printing has certain limitations right now, cost-wise and raw material-wise. And there are also certain other government procedures that needed to be followed before metal printing certain components. Because if a metal printer falls in wrong hands, it can bring a bad result. So there are certain limitations with metal printing, but I am very sure metal printing will reach up to a level wherein you can get all grades of materials which can be used to manufacture dies and molds.
One question which I've received is that, is it possible to use the PET resin as a plastic raw material?
No, resins can be infused with certain plastic. Like there is a company which delivers resin, and you can ask them to composite your resin using plastic powder, metal powder, ceramic powder, different kinds of things. So resins have certain limitations, but then the shrinkage issue with resin with composite materials is very much, it needs to be controlled on a larger basis. So it will give you some problems. PET with resin is not a good idea.
There is one question which is actually related to medical field. It says so that the patient specific surgical solutions plays a vital role in today's era, but still there are no clear guidelines available in medical sectors. So how we look forward to FDA and other American based organizations regarding the clearance of using the 3D printing technology to make certain things?
Okay, so this is a very interesting question. Actually, what happens is when we talk about implants, the implants are made up of mostly two materials. It is SS and titanium, most of the time, which are approved grades of implant materials. So these materials are available in additive manufacturing. There are certain, when we talk about medical, we had done a case on which we replaced the lower jaw, which we call as mandible, the lower jaw of human. So there was a portion which was damaged due to accident. We redesigned it. We got it casted into titanium, and then it was implanted. So when you approach to these authorities, you need to convince them based on the technology used to manufacture it, the strength as well as the material of it. So this is what you can do basically. And there are certain problems when awareness is concerned and all. So there are a lot of restrictions using in medical printing. Biomedical printing has also reached to a level where they have actually 3D printed organs. A finger, a ear, and a nose is already 3D printed. They are working on kidney and liver. So, but the process of approval and is a long process when it comes to implants. But if you have something which is on the outer, like prosthetics and all, to get permissions is easy.
Mohit, one very important question. When we are talking about the 3D printing technology, what are the typical accuracies while printing with metal?
When we talk about printing with metal, you can go up to 100 microns in 3D printing, and then you need to have certain kinds of machining done after metal printing to achieve more precision and accuracy. And we have seen components whose accuracy is less than 20 microns direct out of a metal printer. So, it depends on the component, and it depends on how you manufacture that component using metal printing.
Okay. One more question which I've received. It says that in auto ancillary sector, the world is moving towards providing advanced solutions like cooling channels and tools and molds, etc. And looking for mass customization across various sectors for better customer support and custom solutions, next level quality, but still organizations are not giving that much preference to additive manufacturing. So what exactly is lagging in matching the pace with developed world, or where exactly we people are lacking? It is technology, okay, or it is man force, or it is the knowledge?
No, it is no, the automotive companies have started using additive manufacturing intensively, but in the R&D process currently, in the research process, they have started using these technologies like, you know, the design technologies, the automation, robotics, and additive manufacturing in their designing process. But when it comes to providing customized solution to the automotive client, it is not yet, because, you know, they need to have designing set up everywhere where they need customization. Like if you are in Delhi and you want a car seat which is made according to your custom body and the shape and the features, you need to have a design team there. They design it using 3D scanning or manually measuring the component, and then go for additive manufacturing. So technology is, and also the manpower, the designing manpower is very less. And you have to set up such kinds of labs in every offices that where you want to give customized solution. So that is a big challenge there.
I received one very one question which is very specific, that
right,
what is going to be the price for 300 × 300 × 300 mm 3D printing machine?
300 × 300 × 300 will, there are, you know, certain open source machines also available. You can get a 300 × 300 at approx, you can say 45,000 to 50,000. A good quality machine.
I'm just looking forward to have certain questions from some other participants.
Yeah, sure.
Any machine model suggestions for educational institutes?
Yeah, there are small machines. We actually give it to schools and colleges. Most of them, you know, they are assembled here in India. You can start those machines. The range of those machines starts from 25,000 and it goes up to 2.5 lakhs. You can use MakersBot, Ultimakers, Creality, all such kinds of FDM machines for schools and colleges.
Mohit, there is one question which is actually, and I'm asking again from you,
right,
that a participant is saying that the PET raw material used for making water bottles, can it be used for 3D printing of PET bottles?
Yes, the PET material is available in form of filament, which can be used for FDM 3D printing. But it you cannot reuse that. You need to have virgin and new granules of PET. Those granules are molded into filaments, and you can use those filaments for FDM 3D printing for PET material.
Mohit, one very important question from my side also, that
yes,
where exactly we people are standing as far as 3D printing is concerned in India?
3D printing, when concerned in India, it is limited to a chapter in the engineering college currently. And maybe a few, you know, there are vocational subjects. I think, you know, there is a big gap wherein education institutes need to come up from schools itself. Not only engineering colleges, but from the schools. Like when you say, year 25 years ago, India was lagging in the field of IT. And today, India is the largest provider for skilled IT manpower worldwide. You name any big IT companies and you have Indians leading those companies. So there is the same problem. If we don't catch up to the industry speed right now in the field of additive manufacturing, India will lag behind in the same. So we need more training institutes for additive manufacturing. We need more teachers who are trained in the field of additive manufacturing and who can train those students for that. And you need to have a lot of awareness and campaigning. It should not be limited to a co-curricular or an extracurricular activity, which is right now, or a vocational thing. It should be made as a mainstream education subject.
That's great. A good insight. Mohit, how many Indian OEMs are presently engaged in AM machines in metal?
Metal, No, metal, there are no Indian companies yet. The best one is from Germany, EOS. The second best is Markforged, which is a US-based company. And there are a few Chinese companies into metal 3D printing. India has just started utilizing, and the government has not declared the rules and regulations for medical, for metal 3D printing yet. So to have a metal printer, you need to go through a long paper process first.
Okay. Is it also possible to use different materials while using the 3D printing? For example, one layer I can use of resin, the second layer I can use of something else, and then third layer is something else.
So there is this technology called MJP. So it uses different kinds of materials at the same time, like you are saying. We want one, but it is dependent on you cannot combine resin and plastic, but yes, you can use different kinds of plastics together or different kinds of resins together.
Okay. And yeah. What about the strength?
Strength, yes, you can achieve good strength, equivalent to a product manufactured using traditional method.
I'm just waiting for some more questions from the participants.
Yes, yes, of course.
Mohit, do you have any sample machine product which you have recently manufactured by using additive manufacturing? Like, if you can show it to the camera, if you have it right now with you.
I can show you a sample. Just give me a moment. Well, a bit blue component. Well, So these are automotive components. This is a dog clutch, you can see. It is used to change gears. And this is a similar dog clutch which is used for other applications. Both are automotive components, and these are used as patterns for green sand casting. Like when you want to go for sand casting, you need wooden patterns or maybe metal patterns. So here what we did is printed this out of a MBM. This is a plastic prototype, and it was used for green sand casting. These are certain automotive components that we have.
And I can also see a small 3D printer which is there in behind your chair.
Yeah. I can show you. This is a very small machine. Just to show you the size, let me put the component there. So this is a small component which can be manufactured in this machine. This is for mostly educational purposes for schools and colleges. When they want to learn what 3D printing is to start with, this is a very small machine for that. And there is one more machine here. This is from a company in Czech Republic. So this is also used, but this is a big size printer. So you can have components as large as such components.
And what is going to be the basic education qualifications which is required while going ahead with the 3D printing, learning 3D printing?
So the basic qualification is, kids from fifth standards and plus can start using this technology. Because, you know, you only need to have computer skills initially.
Okay.
And other things can be trained on.
I believe that there is no coding as such. This is only about designing the things in MasterCAD.
Yeah. You can use MasterCAD for designing. There are also certain open source softwares like Tinkercad, which school students are already using. So okay. when they want to make certain shapes, they want to learn shapes, they can make keychains with their name or any small things which they can use in their education as well. Or there are certain scientific miniature models where they can learn different parts of body or different parts of a cell, so they can make certain scientific prototypes using 3D printing and Tinkercad software.
Mohit, I remember that you have shown us one of the video. It was regarding right. Motorcycle which was developed by some engineers in Italy, Germans.
Yeah.
So, like that complete motorcycle was done by using 3D printing or some components, if I'm not mistaken.
No, the body of the motorcycle was entirely 3D printed. And then they used the electronics and they installed all those things. But the body was entirely 3D printed.
Okay. And what type of, do you have any specific, like what type of material they have used for making that particular body?
They use carbon fiber for that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it is actually a lightweight also, if I'm not mistaken.
It is lightweight and it gives strength equivalent to steel.
And it was operated on petrol or it
electric, is electric.
It was electric one.
It was electric, yeah.
That's great. So if we want to calculate certain, like if I wanted to manufacture something,
right.
How exactly I can do my calculation based on 3D manufacturing technologies?
So there are two open source softwares for which one naming is Qora and Repeater Host. You can download this software. You can convert your design file into .stl format. Import that file into the Qora. It will show you how much time it will need for 3D printing, what is the amount of material that will be used. So for FDM, it is open. But when you talk about resin and other special materials and metal printing, you need to send your design to the service bureau for the calculation.
That's great. Thank you.
Yeah. Welcome, Harsh.
So I hope some more questions from the participants because we have received a good number of questions, in fact.
Right. Additive manufacturing is mostly, you know, it can be used in any field. It has no limitation. The limitations are your imagination. So where your imagination stops, that will be the limit of additive manufacturing. It's just that you need to select the necessary raw material and the technology for additive manufacturing.
That's great.
Yeah.
Mohit, behalf of all the participants and from the Capital Good Skill Council, I thank you very much for such an informative session. And I believe that there were many takeaways for the participants and they have a good learning so far.
Except for the part where we lost the audio and video for a few times.
Yes.
Really sorry for
apologize
that.
Apologize to all the participants for
unfortunate
thing.
Yes. Thank you so much. Thank you, Harsh, for this platform. And CGSE is always very close. Looking forward for more sessions and interactions with CGSE.
Thank you.
All the participants.
Thank you very much to everybody. Thank you very much for joining us for today.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a nice day. Thank you.